stories were first told over 1,000 years ago in Persia by a very clever woman called Sihirazam. The king wanted to cut off her head, but every night she kept him fascinated by telling him a story and leaving it in a very exciting place so that he would want to find out what happened next. saw it at night. Aladdin was stunned when he heard the news. But presently, he took down the lamp and rubbed it. The genie of the lamp appeared, saying, "What is thy will?" Aladdin replied, "The sultan has broken his promise to me, and the vizier's son is to marry the princess. My command is that you bring me the princess here, so that the scoundrel can't help her." "Your will is my command," said the genie. But in an instant, the princess was sitting in Aladdin's room, still wearing her wedding dress. He told her not to be afraid, but she was utterly confused and quite terrified. The next morning, the genie took her back to the palace. The princess told her mother how she had been carried by magic to some strange house. Her mother did not believe her in the least, and the sultan ordered that the wedding should take place that evening instead. The following night, exactly the same thing happened. The sultan was furious and even considered having his daughter's head cut off. He summoned the vizier's son. "Lately, my daughter is hiding from you," he said. "Do you still wish to marry her?" "Well," said the young man, who was very proud and arrogant, "if the princess does not obey her father, the great sultan, what hope is there that she will make me a good wife? I give up my claim of her. Better that she marry the poorest beggar, if that's what she wants." When the 3 months were over, Aladdin sent his mother to remind the sultan of his promise. She stood in the same place as before, and the sultan, on seeing her poverty, felt less inclined than ever to keep his word. The vizier had advised him to set so high a value on the princess that no man living could come up to it. The sultan then turned to Aladdin's mother, saying, "Good woman, the sultan must remember his promises, and I will remember mine. But your son must first send me 40 basins of gold full of jewels. Tell him that I await his answer." When he heard this, Aladdin summoned up his genie, and soon 80 slaves, splendidly dressed, were awaiting in the alleyway outside his house. The slaves were carrying 40 golden basins, brimming with jewels. Aladdin mounted his horse and passed through the streets, the slaves strewing gold as they went. When the sultan saw him, he came down from his throne, embraced him, and led him into a hall where a great feast was spread, intending to marry him to the princess that very day. But Aladdin refused, saying, "I must know the palace fit for her," and took his leave. Once home, he said to the genie, "Build me a palace of the finest marble, with 420 windows set with jasper and agate and other precious stones." At night, the princess said goodbye to her father and set out for Aladdin's palace, with his magic arm to stop it. But instead of perishing miserably in the cave, he had escaped and had married a princess. He traveled night and day until he reached the city of Persia, where Aladdin lived. Half mad with rage, he was determined to get hold of the lamp and again plunge Aladdin into the deepest poverty. Invite him to sup with you and say you wish to taste the wine of this country. He will go for some wine, and while he is gone, I will tell you what to do. That evening, she received the magician, saying to his great amazement, I have made my mind up that Aladdin is dead, and that all my tears will not bring him back to me. So I am resolved to mourn no more, and have therefore invited you to sup with me. But let us try some wine of Africa. The magician flew into his cellar, and the princess put the powder Aladdin had given her into his cup. When he returned, the magician made her a speech in praise of her beauty. But the princess cut him short, saying, let us drink first, and you shall say what you want afterwards. She set her cup to her lips and kept it there, while the magician drained his to the dregs and fell back lifeless. Aladdin came into the room, went to the dead magician, took the lamp out of his clothes, and bade the genie carry the palace and all in it back to Persia. This was done in an instant. The sultan, who was sitting in his chamber, mourning for his lost daughter, happened to look up and rubbed his eyes. But there stood the palace as before. He hastened to it, and Aladdin received him with the princess at his side. He told him what had happened, and showed him the dead body of the magician that he might believe. A 10-day feast was proclaimed. And it seemed as if Aladdin might now live the rest of his life in peace. But it was not to be. The African magician had a younger brother, who was, if possible, more wicked and cunning than himself. He traveled to Persia to avenge his brother's death, and disguised himself in skirts and veils, so that he looked exactly like a famous holy woman called Fatima. Then he went toward the palace of Aladdin, and all the people, thinking he was the holy woman, gathered round him, kissing his hands and begging his blessing. The princess, who had long desired to see Fatima, sent for him. She showed Fatima the palace, and asked what she thought of it. It is truly beautiful, said the false Fatima. In my mind, it wants but one thing. And what is that? Said the princess. If only a rock's egg, replied he, would hang up on the mirror. Story.com. I'll be back.